يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا
إذ قال الله يا عيسى إني متوفيك ورافعك إلي
محمد رسول الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. We are still in the beginning of Surah At-Tawbah. At-Tawbah means repentance. And At-Tawbah as repentance is mentioned in the Surah many, many times. And the subject of the Surah and those who are mentioned in the Surah are the disbelievers, the hypocrites, and the believers. And they're all invited to repent and called to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with whatever sins when it comes to these types of individuals. And this is basically the entire humanity, either disbelievers or believers or hypocrites. And for the disbelievers to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to believe in Allah, that He's the only one worthy of worship, to embrace the religion of Islam, to apply the orders of Allah, to know the purpose of their life. And for the hypocrites to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from hypocrisy, from having disbelief in their hearts, they hide it, and they pretend to be among the believers, to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from that and to rectify their corruption and their evil doing that they do by spreading this evil throughout the earth. And for the believers to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all sins. So it becomes the lifetime job of the believer is to be constant in that state of repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're still in the beginning verses of the surah that talked about the declaration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the disbelievers, those who had the treaty with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They broke their treaty with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disassociating Himself and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from these treaties and giving them the time and giving them the warnings and showing them the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after that, and this is what we will try to discuss inshallah ta'ala, verses number 6 all the way to number 10 from Surah At-Tawbah, from 6 to 10, how the ways and the affairs of the evildoers, those who have an upon aggression, the aggressive disbelievers, those who were not just disbelievers, but they are doing acts of aggression against the believers to eliminate the truth from the face of earth for no reason but to wipe away the matter of the deen from the face of earth. These individuals with their aggression, the verses shows some of the things that is even in their own inside intentions and their hearts, exposing them for the believers to be warned against them. Those who would show this aggression, that's what's their purpose and their injustices and their evil doing. When they are in aggression, they don't respect any laws or any principles. They spread evil and they shed blood and they do all kinds of evil doing, and this is what we, even as human beings, they know today about what wars is. But when it comes to the believers, their affairs is totally different. Even though they, when they are indulged into wars and it's justified and it's for the sake of Allah and to make the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala superior, it's not about committing evil. The believers, they are upon righteousness, they're upon justice, and they would never do any acts of aggression in the sense that it's evil and spreading evil and corruption and so on, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders them to be just, even when they are in the context of war, to be just, to be righteous, to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it's not about one's personal benefit, but rather it's all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So continuing with these rulings, and from verses number 6 to number 10, we'll start with verse number 6. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَ ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Which means, and if anyone of the polytheists seeks your protection, then grant him protection so that he may hear the words of Allah. then deliver him to his place of safety. That is because they are a people who do not know. This is after mentioning the 4 months period where the disbelievers, they were given the chance, the time, after the declaration of breaking this treaty that they broke from their end when they betrayed the Prophet ﷺ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most just, he ordered the Prophet ﷺ to declare the disassociation, to distant oneself from these treaties that they did not honor, and given them 4 months so that they would take their means and then they leave and so on. Otherwise, they will be fought against. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then afterwards, he mentions to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ. If any of the mushrikeen, a mushrikeen is the plural of a mushrik, and the mushrik is the one that commits shirk, and shirk is associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if one of these disbelievers is tajarak, that means they basically ask you for protection. Istajarak, that means they're asking for the jiwar or the protection, you know, and this is disbelievers in the context of they're supposed to be fought against because they're evildoers and they're aggressive and they are in the act of aggression. But if they seek protection from you, O Prophet of Allah, فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. أَجِرْهُ, that means ordering the Prophet ﷺ and the believers to grant them the protection, not to harm them if they ask you for protection. So this is, we're talking about the context of war. And this is an enemy. This is in combat. This is someone that is, his intentions there is to kill and to shed blood. So the Prophet, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering the Prophet ﷺ, if one of them, he seeks your protection, then give him, grant him the protection. Do not kill him, do not harm him. He's seeking your protection. حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. Till he hears the speech of Allah, the Qur'an. Till he hears the message of Al-Islam. Give him the protection and give him the time for him to hear the words of Allah. Invite him to the deen of Al-Islam. Let him listen to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the speech of Allah, the Qur'an. And then what to do to him afterwards? ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَا. Then deliver him to his place of safety. Do not, even if he continues in his disbelief, yes. So when he hears the speech of Allah, when he hears the truth, he has one of two things that he would do. Either that he will be among the believers, and the matter is easy, then it's very clear, then he's one of you, and he will have all of the rights of the believers and the goodness and so on. Or if he refuses, if he chooses to continue in that state of disbelief after the truth has been made clear to him, what to do to him, O Prophet of Allah? Deliver him, take him to his safety. This is such an amazing meanings here that people, when they really reflect upon the orders of Allah, upon the Quran, they would see perfectness in everything. When it comes into the subject of justice, perfect justice. When it comes to mercy, perfect mercy. All manners, all behaviors, all ibadat, acts of worship, matters of belief. There is nothing in the Quran unless it's perfect, according to the worldly means, and of course in the hereafter. This is the deen of Allah. This is the speech of Allah. This is the perfect and miraculous speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with its rulings, with its instructions, and so on. So here, the ruling again for us to be clear about it. This is in combat, this is in fighting. And a disbeliever in war against the believers in this context. And he seeks your protection, grant him the protection. Do not cause harm to him. Grant him the protection and let him listen. Hear the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Invite him to the deen of Al-Islam. And when they hear the speech of Allah, the Quran, if they become believers, then they are your brothers in faith, as it will come also in the verses. And if they don't, if that person refuses and he says, and you can imagine someone as if he's captive, he's caught and he's under captivity, and people in that state usually they get scared and they would do whatever their enemies and those who caught them, that whatever they say to them, they would do it. But in that context, if he refuses, if he says no, I will continue to adhere to my religion, to his disbelief, then what to do about that person? Kill him? Of course not. Continue his captivity? Lock him up in prison because of his decision? None of that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, but rather the justice of Allah. And even more, the justice of Allah and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that ordering the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if he hears the speech of Allah, then take him to where he is safe so that nobody harms him. You free him, you let him go, you don't capture him. You let him free, you let him to his safety, and then you leave him. ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَةً. Then deliver him, make him reach the place of security and safety for him. This is an amazing thing, and that's why we need to reflect upon this. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Why is that? Why treat them in such a way? Because there are people that do not know. And when someone does not know, that means your duty is to let them know. And that's what the da'wah is. This is what the call is. To get people to know the truth. So this is, even they are people that they are in the context of fighting against you, but they do not know. Many of them, they do not know. So this is the ruling with regards to those who they seek protection, is to make them listen to the speech of Allah. And that's an evidence clearly that the Quran is the speech of Allah. And then you deliver them to their safety, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because there are people that do not know. When a person is ignorant about something, then to treat that person, imagine this is in the context of war. Imagine then when it's not in the context of war. Someone that doesn't know how to treat that person, teach him, educate him, get him to know the truth. You know, many people, they do not know the message of the Quran, the message of the deen of Islam. They have a negative understanding of it because of the evil doing of the industry that spread evil. And the job of the believers is to educate them, is to get them to know the truth, because they do not know. So if this is a verse in such a hostile environment in the war, so you can imagine then how the effect, and how can we learn from this when it's times of ease and people are meeting and traveling with each other and interacting with each other. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Then after that, the verses talks about the reality of the disbelievers, or at least a group of them, those who are upon aggression, and what they did to the Prophet ﷺ, the people of Mecca, the people of Quraysh, and they are from the same tribe and from the same blood and things of that nature, and how they treated the Prophet ﷺ and the companions radiallahu anhum. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention them as people of Quraysh or people of this place or that place, but rather with their characteristics. That is, they were upon, and that is al-shirk, associating partners with Allah, and they were in that state of aggression. How did they deal with this? Were they just? Were they, you know, people of goodness and justice, or were they the total opposite? The next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verse number 7, كَيْفَ يَكُونُ لِلْمُشْرِكِينَ عَهْدٌ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَعِنْدَ رَسُولِهِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ عَاهَدْتُمْ عِنْدَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ فَمَا اسْتَقَامُوا لَكُمْ فَاسْتَقِيمُوا لَهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Which means, how can there be for the polytheists a treaty in the sight of Allah and with His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, except for those with whom you made a treaty at al-masjid al-haram? So as long as they are upright towards you, be upright towards them. Indeed, Allah loves the righteous who fears Him. So this is a question that the answer of it is very obvious. How can there be a treaty, you know, from these disbelievers, from these polytheists, from those who commit shirk, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Meaning, they don't hold any and do not honor any treaty because of their shirk, because they associate partners with Allah. There's no principles in them. You know, they would hold and honor the treaty only if it brings them benefit. If they benefit from it, if they are weaker than the believers, they would honor the treaty. They would never break it, and they would never plot against the believers because they're weak. And they wait for the chance and the moment where they can cause harm to the believers, and they betray them. So this is basically what the verses are saying. That means have the ultimate cautious against them, because there are people that they do not honor their treaty and their promises and so on. Why? Because this worldly gain is the ultimate thing for them. They do not believe in the hereafter and so on. So how can they then have a covenant or a treaty عند الله, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, except إِلَّا الَّذِينَ عَاهَدْتُمْ عِنْدَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ, except those who you have the treaty with them by the Masjid al-Haram. So what to do about them, those who they honor their treaty and you still have that ahd and the covenant with them, what to do with regards to them? فَمَا اسْتَقَامُوا لَكُمْ. As long as they're upright, they doing what is right, and al-istiqama is to be upright, to be steadfast. As long as they're honoring their treaty, فَاسْتَقِيمُوا لَهُمْ. Then treat them equally with justice. That means oppose that with goodness, be upright to them. As long as they're upright to you, and of course the understanding of that, if they're not upright, if they break their covenant, if they betray you, then you treat them with justice, and that means there's no treaty anymore. And you declare what's mentioned in the beginning of the surah to them, that there's no treaty between them and you anymore because they were not upright. إِنَّ اللَّهِ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَّقِينَ is repeated again in the surah, that indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved the righteous ones. Those who fear Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved them. And you see how the muttaqeen is mentioned in this context. The muttaqeen, those who fear Allah, those who are dutiful to Allah, are the ones that would oppose justice with justice and goodness with goodness. They don't betray, they don't commit wrongdoing with those who are nice to them, even if it's in the context of war and bloodshed and the like of that. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala with more after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammadur Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Welcome back, and with verses in Surah At-Tawbah, verses number 6 to number 10. And with verse number 7, we heard how the mushrikeen, the polytheists, they don't keep a treaty. Those who do not keep their treaty, those who broke their treaty and they caused all kinds of evil, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, how can they keep their treaty when they committed evil and so on, except those who had their treaty in the Masjid al-Haram. So with the condition, فَمَا اسْتَقَامُوا لَكُمْ فَاسْتَقِيمُوا لَهُمْ. If you are in a treaty and they're being upright towards you, then you be upright towards them. And that's the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because indeed Allah loves the muttaqeen. The muttaqeen, they are like this. There are people that you can feel secure with them. If you are in a treaty with them, as long as you're upright towards them, they would never betray you. They would treat you with justice, with goodness, and they would never break their treaty. And then the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains of how the disbelievers, those who upon aggression, and what do they do when they are superior, when they have means, how do they treat the believers? Verse number 8, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كَيْفَ وَإِنْ يَظْهَرُوا عَلَيْكُمْ لَا يَرْقُبُوا فِيكُمْ إِلَّا وَلَا ذِمَّةٌ يُرْضُونَكُمْ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَتَأْبَى قُلُوبُهُمْ وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Which means, how can there be a treaty while if they gain dominance over you, they do not observe concerning you any pact of kinship or covenant of protection? They satisfy you with their mouths, but their hearts refuse compliance, and most of them are defiantly disobedient. This is the affairs of the people of Quraysh with the Prophet ﷺ and those who are upon aggression. كَيْفَ وَإِنْ يَظْهَرُوا عَلَيْكُمْ. How is it when they are dominant over you? Something that brings also for the believers to be wise and to be upon reason and to be warned against the evildoers. If they are dominant against you, and this is not everyone, but for those who are upon these evil actions, كَيْفَ وَإِنْ يَظْهَرُوا عَلَيْكُمْ. يَظْهَرُوا عَلَيْكُمْ, that means they are apparent over you, they are dominant against you, over you. They have the upper hand. And the disbelievers, they have the upper hand, yes, because this is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. وَتِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَوِرُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. This is how the days, you know, changes. One era, the believers are weak, and other times they are strong, and vice versa. And this has sunan, ways that never changes when it comes to matters of belief, of course. If the believers, they hold fast to the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make them superior on the land to see how are they going to be obedient to Allah. How are they going to apply the orders of Allah? Are they going to be when they're dominant? Are they going to act in the same way as the disbelievers in their aggression, in their injustice, in their evil doing? Or are they going to be upon justice and mercy and goodness and so on? And if they observe the orders of Allah, they will continue to be superior. But if they break the covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they do not follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then the matter will be changed and they will have the lower hand and the disbelievers will be dominant upon them. Not because the disbelievers are good, but because the believers, they turned away from being upright and being among those who apply the orders of Allah. So, كَيْفَ وَإِنْ يَظْهَرُوا عَلَيْكُمْ. When the disbelievers, when the polytheists, when the people of Quraysh, when they're dominant upon you, what do they do? لَا يَرْقُبُوا فِيكُمْ إِلَّا وَلَا ذِمَّ. لَا يَرْقُبُوا فِيكُمْ, that means they don't even recognize. They will not even observe anything concerning you, anything of kinship or covenant or of protection. That means kinship and covenant of protection. These two things might be considered when someone is dominant. So when someone, you know, when people are dealing with each other, there is some form of enmity between them, and one is dominant over the other. Usually, you know, this is enemies, enmity. So the evil doing of many of the human beings, their concern is to wipe their enemies. But what are the things that might make their aggression, you know, contained in some way? Is there, if there's any kinship, you know, brothers, for example, when they're in state of enmity with one another or dispute, there's kinship, or there's a covenant between two parties. So these two things are two reasons why people, even if they are dominant, they won't act in state of aggression, but rather they would consider the kinship. They would consider that there's a treaty between the two parties and they would honor it. And it doesn't mean that you only honor your treaty when you're weak and oppressed, because many of the people on the face of earth, this is how their way of life. If they are weak and oppressed and don't have the means, and they are in a treaty with their enemies, they will observe it. They will respect it and they would say, MashaAllah, we're such great people. But what if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them power and strength and they become dominant over their enemies? How would they treat them? Would they treat them with injustice, or they would still observe justice treating them? And this is what makes the believers unique and different than the rest of the world. And this is something, is a meaning that many people, they do not recognize or think about. When you think even about minorities, and this is, you know, just taken aside here and with the verse to learn this benefit. When you think about minorities on the face of earth, you have a country, for example, and there's a minority there. Right? The minority usually, because it's minority, behave itself well, following the rules and orders and so on. And they are in state of fear, you know, in some cases, of course, unless there's justice in the land, you know, for their own being. So they would act in a certain way because they are minority, they are weak. But what happens when this minority becomes dominant? Especially that if the majority or those who were dominant, they were abusing them and they were treating them with injustice. Say, for example, what would be the other side do when they are weak? They will be observing basically what a weak person or a weak nation would do. But then when they are given dominance, usually that's the norm, they would treat their enemies in the worst and the worst harsh way whatsoever. They would treat them with injustice, they would shed blood and so on. But this is not the case for the believers. The believers, if they are treated in the worst way ever because they are weak and minority and so on, if things changes and the believers, they become dominant in the land, how they are supposed to treat the ones that abuse them? They are ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to treat them with justice, to treat them with whatever goodness there is, and that's what makes the believers unique. That's what makes them the most secure individuals that you can ever deal with them, if they are believers, if they know the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when it comes to the disbelievers, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned them, they don't observe any of the kinship that you have between you and them, as the people of Quraysh did with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Or any treaty, they don't respect that. Why? Because now they have dominance. Nobody will oppose them. Nobody will stop them. This is how they think. So why should they be honest? Why should they keep their treaty when they have a chance to win and to defeat their enemies and so on? Usually people will act according to this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is condemning them. So how is it then when they are dominant over you and they don't observe any of the kinship between you and them? They would not observe any of the treaty that is between you and them. More, يرضونكم بأفواههم. They please you with their mouth. When you are dominant, right, they'll please you with their mouth. وتأبى قلوبهم. But their hearts is in defiance. Their hearts refuses to comply. وأكثرهم فاسقون. And most of them are defiantly disobedient. These are the people that the end justified the means for them. They would act as if they are the best people on the face of earth as long as they are weak and oppressed. Once they have the upper hand, no principles, no goodness, no justice, nothing whatsoever. And this is what we see how the world is acting, unless there is faith and belief and goodness and more of deception and so on. This is how their life is. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Most of them are defiantly disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if someone is defiantly disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why would that person be, you know, observing what is goodness? There's no principles. Then any evil that person can commit, any evil these people can commit, because they are defiantly disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after that, the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention about them and talks about even more of what they do. He said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, اشتروا بآيات الله ثمنا قليلا فصدوا عن سبيله إنهم ساء ما كانوا يعملون. Which means they have exchanged the signs of Allah for a small price and averted the people from His way. Indeed, it was evil that they were doing. اشتروا بآيات الله ثمنا قليلا. اشتروا. اشتروا means they purchased. And purchasing is when you purchase something, you exchange something for something else. You exchanged money for whatever you purchased, or you exchange whatever. So this is exactly what they did. اشتروا بآيات الله ثمنا قليلا. The price that they paid when they purchased, they paid the price is the ayat of Allah, the signs of Allah. They gave that away. In return of what? In return for a small price. ثمنا قليلا. And the small price can be the entire world and whatever it contains. It's a small price compared to what they gave away, which is the ayat of Allah. And this is true for anything when it comes to the deen of Allah. Someone to give away his religion, to compromise the truth, not to be upon the truth of the religion of Islam. In return of what? In return of being famous? In return of being a millionaire? In return of some joy that they would receive on the face of earth? This is exactly like someone purchasing something. When you purchase something, you purchase it with something that you spend, that you give. So the deen, one's religion becomes the price that a person gives his deen for. What in return? For temporary enjoyment, for whatever worldly gain he lost this life and the hereafter, and he gained something temporary. So this is the affairs of the disbelievers. They exchanged by the verses, by the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a small price, which is the entire world and whatever it contains. In return, there's nothing. They would not ever be able to be successful. فَصَدُّ عَن سَبِيلِ. So they opposed the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of that. إِنَّهُمْ سَاءَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. How evil is what they do. That means there's evil that what they're doing. Their evil doing is by disbelieving in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, giving away the ayat of Allah, the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, giving away the truth for something in return, and that is the entire world and whatever it contains, it's considered to be nothing. And that's another benefit that we need to learn from this. And this is the evil doing of them. You know, this is where the disbelievers is very clear, and also for the believers. You know, even for recommended acts, really it's something that we have to be aware of that. Like, and this example was mentioned before, someone to pray the 2 rak'ah of Sunnatul Fajr. Sunnatul Fajr, which is not mandatory. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, رَكَعْتَيْ الْفَجْرِ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهِ. That the 2 rak'ah of Fajr is better than the entire world and whatever it contains. So when someone doesn't pray the Sunnatul Fajr, and the Prophet ﷺ used to pray it whether he is traveling or not, at all times he would pray it. And when a person doesn't pray it, he didn't pray it for what reason? To sleep a little longer? You know, if he's offered the treasures of this life, he should still pray these 2 rak'ah, even if in return of not praying it, he would receive the treasures of the earth, because the Prophet ﷺ said so. You can imagine those who do not pray the Fajr Salah, what they have missed. For what reason? what in return they got from missing Salatul Fajr, and that's only one Salah. When the hadith and the verses of the Quran that talks about it, and this is just one act. The same thing. What did a person gain by indulging in bribery, for example, when stealing, when betraying, when committing sins? What's in return? When committing major sins, adultery, drinking, lying, all of these types of things, what did the person gain? Temporary enjoyment? If he receives in return the entire world and whatever it contains, all of that is going to go away. What happened to the previous nations? What happened to the previous kings and presidents and the richest people on the face of earth and the most famous and so on? Those who before us, those who died, they passed away. They become memory, right? They don't live on the face of earth forever. So why to be deceived when the matter is as we hear? So, اشتروا بآيات الله ثمنا قليلا, very small amount, so they oppose the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How evil is their doing? More of this meanings of the characteristics of the disbelievers versus the justice of the believers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them in Surah At-Tawbah. We'll do that inshallah ta'ala after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammadur Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Welcome back, and with verses number 6 to number 10 from Surah At-Tawbah, the injustices of the disbelievers versus the justice of the believers, and how that al-iman or faith or taqwa, the fear of Allah, orders the person, drives the person to be just, to be merciful, to have the best qualities. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing in these verses how evil the affairs of the disbelievers when they treated the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when they opposed the truth, and they did not observe any kinship or any treaty whatsoever. They broke all covenants. They did not consider any of the kinship that they had with the Prophet ﷺ and his companions. They rage wars against them and they break their treaty and so on. For the believers to be warned against this and to expose the evil affairs of the disbelievers, and that this is something that is looked down upon, and for the believers not to be like this, but rather to be just and to be kind, and showing how the disbelievers, they, in return of some worldly gain that means nothing, they gave away the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the deen of Allah. So how evil is their actions. Then after that, the last verse, verse number 10, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposes the disbelievers more by saying, لَا يَرْقُبُونَ فِي مُؤْمِنٍ إِلَّا وَلَا ذِمَّةٍ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُعْتَدُونَ, which means they do not observe toward the believer any pact of kinship or covenant of protection, and it is they who are the transgressors. Some words are repeated again. لَا يَرْقُبُونَ فِي مُؤْمِنٍ إِلَّا وَلَا ذِمَّةٍ. That means the previous one was instead of when they are dominant, but now here it states that they do not observe towards a believer, فِي مُؤْمِنٍ, not even one believer, any believer. They do not observe towards that believer two things. إِلَّا وَلَا ذِمَّةٍ, any pact of kinship or any covenant of protection. They don't honor that. They don't respect that there's kinship between them and the believers. They don't respect that there's a treaty between them and the believers. So this is their affairs. This is their state. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُعْتَدُونَ, and they are the transgressors. This is the aggression. Because of what? Because they are disbelievers. There's no principles in their life. Whatever, the end justify the means for them. Right, and this is basically the thing that governs their life. And they would loot and they would steal and they would commit all kinds of evil atrocities. And we can see that how, and we can read the history and see what happens to the believers when the believers, they occupy their land. And when they would do all kinds of evil and atrocities and so on, they justify it for themselves because they don't care. They have no means of respecting any kinship or any treaty or even humanity or anything. But for the believers, the matter is different, because the believers, they are sincere. They do things only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala superior. They are not mu'tadun. They're not people of aggression. They don't become aggressive towards others for their own benefit and things of that nature, but rather they treat them with the justice that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them to observe and with the mercy in their hearts towards humanity. These verses, as we heard, even though it talks about some of the things in the context of war, right? This is a subject that needs to be taught. And since this is part of life that people live, you know, and when we talk about war, we would find all kinds of evil as a result of that. And this is such an inevitable situation. You know, this is that's how life is. You know, if nations, they do not protect themselves, they will be attacked. And there's some form of aggression would be acted upon them. And that's why the people in charge, they protect themselves and they protect their people. They have strong means of doing so and so on. And that's how, when it mentions here their enemies and their affairs and their characteristics, so to take cautious and to take means to protect them. And for the believers to be aware of the level of enmity, not to be deceived and not to fall into the trap of imitating their enemies and compromising their religion, because they are constantly working on making the believers compromise their faith, which is the source of their honor and dignity. This is the mean of their establishment, the means of their goodness in this life. So when they are led to decline and to not to observe and the steadfastness upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is how they are going to be treated, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with regards to even to his own people. We learn from these verses that the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the believers are ordered to observe, that if they are in the context of war and one of their enemies, they seek protection, that they should honor them the protection and they should not betray them. And they should let them listen to the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran. And if they refuse to observe and to follow the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they should be taken to a safe place so that they're not harmed, so that they're not betrayed, and showing that they are people that do not know. So they are need to be educated for them to get to know the truth. And even if they know and they continue to be in the state of disbelief, then don't harm them. Take them to their place of safety. And then these verses that talks about the affairs, that's why the surah, one of the names of the surah, Surah Tawbah, is Al-Fadiha. It exposes the affairs of the disbelievers and the hypocrites in many, many verses. For the believers to take means of protection so that they do not get deceived by the ways of the disbelievers, and how that people, you know, they become different when they are dominant, and when to honor the treaty. Those who honor it, those who are upright, then be upright towards them. That's the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not break the treaty as long as the other side are honoring their treaty and they're not breaking it. And if they break it, then you have to follow what's mentioned in the beginning of the surah, declaring, informing them, make it clear, and not to also fall into acts of betraying them or doing all kinds of evil actions. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentioned that He loves the muttaqeen. So this is all attributes of Allah. One of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned there is the speech of Allah. The Quran is the speech of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke the Quran. And one of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love the muttaqeen, love the people of taqwa, those who fear Allah, those who are dutiful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that one of the meanings of the taqwa, one of the outcome of the taqwa, and the many folds of taqwa, is when they are dealing with their enemies, right? They're still upon taqwa. They still observe the fear of Allah. And they still are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the believers, when the people of taqwa and piety, they are dominant against the disbelievers, they treat them the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them, with justice, with goodness. They don't treat them the same way the disbelievers, they would treat them with evil and aggression and so on. Also, we learn from this that when the dominance is on the sides of the disbelievers, right, they don't observe any kinship or any treaty, you know, and they would please you with their mouth. They would say all kinds of things that pleases you. That's the deception that people are living, in which they would listen and they would hear all kinds of nice words, pleasing the believers, that we are there to protect you, we are there to push away evil from you, and so on and so forth. And in reality, these disbelievers that are there to destroy the believers. and to continue their destruction and to commit injustice against them. وَتَأْبَى قُلُوبُهُمْ And their hearts are defiant to comply with the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And most of them are fasiqoon. They are defiantly disobedient, and because of that, they spread disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in whatever lands they go to. They intentionally corrupt the people. They hate to see righteous people to be pious, to be pure, to be upon goodness and worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and having chastity and having observing the pure manners and so on. They would spread corruption among them. They would spread all kinds of evil sins and adultery and the like of that. Why? Because they are fasiqoon. They are in that state of defiantly disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned why. Because they gave away the signs of Allah. In return of what? Some worldly gain that is temporary. And where they can go, they would never be able to go anywhere outside the dominion of the heavens and the earth. They are under the power of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the sovereignty of the heavens and the earth. So where can they escape from the punishment of Allah in this case? How evil is their actions and the act of evil doing and aggression and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeated the fact twice that whenever they are dominant, they don't observe any act of kinship or treaty between you and them. So that means be warned against them. And they are the one that having that state of al-i'tida or aggression, which condemning the state of aggression because this is evil, but rather for the believers to be just. The next verse, but we don't have the time to mention it this time, inshallah ta'ala, we'll continue next time. It talks about with all of these evil actions from the disbelievers that are mentioned and that we just heard, still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invite them to repent to Allah. So the next verse will talk about if they repent to Allah and if they establish the salah and they pay the zakah, they are your brothers in deen. فَإِخْوَانُكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ They are your brothers. You can see how this enmity was there, but all of a sudden becomes brotherhood. Based on what? Based on matters of al-Iman and good deeds, establishing the salah and paying the zakah and so on. Which shows the importance of this brotherhood in the deen of al-Islam. This is the highest level of faith. It's for people to love for the sake of Allah and to hate for the sake of Allah. For them to be brothers for the sake of Allah. So even though they did so much evil, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is inviting them to repent. And that's the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something that whoever turn away from all of these calls to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are mentioned throughout the entire Quran. And the entire life are all things for us to learn. One incident after another, one chance after another. Every breath we take on the face of earth is all means and ways for us to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before we're not able to, before the moment of death comes to the person. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called them to repent and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after being, as we heard in these verses. But we'll talk about that inshallah ta'ala next time. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who learn the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to apply what we learn and to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be among the people of the Quran. So till next time, I leave you with the protection of Allah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
الذين تابوا وأصلحوا وبينوا فأولئك أتوب عليهم وأنا التواب الرحيم
فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون
يا زكريا إنا نبشرك بغلام
Shut